Hi, Shirley Adams with Series 10, Program 9 of The Sewing Connection. We finally got over the big dilemma of where skirt hems should be by deciding to wear them at the most flattering length. Now the questions I get are about pants. How wide? Again, whatever flatters you most because you see them very wide as well as very slim. Think about the fabric weight, your weight, and try on some ready-to-wear to analyze from every view to make a wise decision. Basically, the wider the leg is, the thinner the fabric needs to be. Think about wearing a pair of jeans, for instance. Usually it's kind of fitted, they're kind of slim, and that's a pretty heavy, sturdy, crisp fabric, kind of stiff. If, on the other hand, you would wear something out of, tissue file or some party pant type fabric, then you'd have to have them wide because they really look sleazy if they're too narrow. So think about it in that way. Whether it's narrow or wide, it depends on whether it's light or heavy weight. Now, it's very easy to change the width down in the leg, down at the ankle, of any pair of pants, whatever pattern you use. So don't necessarily, as you look through the pattern books or make your decisions, don't necessarily worry about having the exact right pattern. You can change that so simply. Here, for instance, on the table is an adjustable pattern. And right now I have these for absolutely straight legs. They just come straight down. And what that is about, a 20-inch leg, I think, in total, because what we have here is 10 inches. There are no seams or no hem on this. So this is going to be a wider leg than we've been seeing for a while, but it's not nearly as wide as some as you see. The pants I have on, I started, now they're lightweight. This is a rayon challis. It's a real lightweight one. And I started out with 24 inch. I thought that would be good, so I widened the legs. After I had them all made, I felt like a graduate of a clown college. It didn't work out right on me. On someone else, it would have been just wonderful, perhaps. Your height also has something to do with it. I'm about average height. If you're a tall person, you can wear them wider. Short people should slim down a little bit there in the ankle, probably. But anyway, they can adjust easily. This one I can adjust by just loosening a knob and tightening it here, and I can make it narrow very easily. I can do the reverse also to make it wide. If you're using a paper pattern, what you want to do is add the very same amount to both sides of the leg. So that means if I had this pattern, and I'll just go ahead and trace it, so that we have this one. Now, I've already set this one for a size, happens to be my size, but I've set the waist and the hips are right and everything is just as it should be. And what I would do when I trace around this is, of course, this is the stitching line, and you would have to add to this the seam lines, and you'd also have to add a hem. But if we just have the basic pants, and I moved it a little bit, if we just have the basic pants, then we can make those differences very easily. And what I would like to do is, in this one it has a dart, so no problems there. We've got a dart. I'll just mark where it is, and here it is. And so we've got a dart, and there's our basic pattern. So, very simple. Now, no pattern manufacturer can account for all the funny quirks in your body, so you're going to have to make some changes, probably, unless you're absolutely what they figure to be average. You will probably change things here and there, but this is for you to get to know your body and decide what the changes are, and then you standardly make them in every pattern you use. Okay, well, from this initial leg, I didn't draw it quite hard enough, dark enough, so I'll draw it again here. From this initial leg, we want to make it perhaps a little wider than this. So what I was saying, do this equally on both sides. And that was one of the very pale, I better darken it a little, that was one of the very pale pens that are water soluble that you're used to using on fabrics. Okay, to make this wider or narrower, decide where it's going to get wider or narrower from. Where does it originate? For instance, the bell bottoms, you still see maybe a couple around, but not a whole lot. They would start right here around the knee or a little below the knee even, and just flare below that. So you'd take just a straight edge, start at that level and go on out, or do it gradually by using some sort of a curve that will curve from there and go out so that you can make them look like they work. So this is where you do it if you wanted bell bottoms. If. Okay, if on the other hand you wanted them just to be wider all the way along, if you had these out of a very lightweight kind of fabric of some sort and were making some dressy pants, chiffon, whatever it might be, then you'd start at your largest part right up here on the hip and widen them from there. So if I would add, oh, let's say, because I'm using this dotted pattern paper, that makes it very easy to add or subtract the amount you want without having to measure. The dots are at every inch. So if I wanted to add an inch to this on each side, and instead of having 10 inches in width here, make it 12 or whatever, just balance it. But I'm going to start to make it straight leg by starting right up here at the top and bringing it down here, and I've got a straight leg pants. If you want something wider, decide where the flare should come, and it also probably starts here. And notice that, look up here in the hip area, and notice that the more I would flare this down at the ankle, probably the higher that point moves up where the flare would start. So that's because it curves, and so this is normal, natural, it does that. But if I'm going to add this extra inch to one side, to the side seam in this case, then I'm going to add the same thing to the inseam here. So I'd mark where I wanted it to be. This is about this much beyond that dot. I just put a dot down there and then see where that nicely connects. Maybe by using a straight edge, but wherever it connects, blend it in so that it isn't an abrupt finish. This is why a curved stick, whether it's a hip curve or whatever it's called, there are several commercial devices on the market, but it's nice to have it to get a smooth, even blend there. So we've made wide leg pants. It's that easy. Now I have a couple of legs down here on the table, and you can see the big difference. These are made from the very same pattern, but they're completely different pants. And you can see that this one's narrower. It's very casual knit outfit, just pants and t-shirt. This one's dressier. It's in a wool crepe, and it's lined, and it goes with a suit jacket. So they're completely different types of pants. So easy to change. What length hem you have that you add down there to the bottom depends also on the fabric. If it's going to be a wider leg, you'll probably have a little wider hem. If it's going to be a lightweight fabric, you'll probably have a wider hem. Heavier weights usually have narrower hems. So make these decisions and look at ready to wear if you need to make some decisions that you can't on your own, and you get some good ideas that way. So that's very easy to make wide or narrow. Now if you have some wide pants, if you've never had wide pants, by the way, better do it fast, because they've been in for, oh, what, 2, 3, 4 years now? And so they could be going the other direction. But right now, for this coming year or two, I see both wide and narrower. So don't worry too much about it. But think about it. If you're in it for the long haul, you might not want them terribly wide. However, if you have any wide leg pants and you later, next year, want to narrow them, you can do that very easily by just reversing the action. Just turn those pants inside out in the sewing room, and whatever you take off one side, take an equal amount off both sides, and you won't even change the crease if you have a crease there, if you've pressed a crease in them. Very often, lately especially, and with the wide legs especially, you aren't seeing as many creases as you do when they're kind of standard straight leg pants. So that's very easy to do. Also realize that as they get longer, get wider, they might get longer. And as if they're a little shorter, they need to be narrower so it doesn't make a funny break there at your ankle. Now you can also do some changing up at the waist just as easily as you can down at the bottom. The changes I'd make at the waist would probably be, these are standard pants. They do have a dart, and that dart would come about like this. In fact, on the pattern that I've moved, it's a straight dart, as you always see in pants and skirts, straight darts. I'm not straight. Right below my waist, I have a little padding, as perhaps you do also. So when I actually stitch this dart, I'm not going to stitch it straight. I will instead stitch kind of a curve like this on both sides as I put it together. And because it curves, then it rounds over your roundness if you have any. There again, a curved stick of some sort might be good to get the line that works just right so that you can draw a smooth, fluid line on that and have a nicer job. So we might do that dart. Then again, all about 4 pair of these pants, plus the pants I'm wearing, don't have darts in them. They instead have just gathered waists. They're elastic at the waist. So what you do for elastic waists is a couple of different choices here. For one thing, I'm going to want them a little bit larger. Remember, if you have an elasticized waist, and if you don't have a zipper and a hook and eye at the waist, you're going to have to pull them up over your hips. So this waistline of the pants has to be whatever your waist measurement is. All four pieces, of course, front, left and right, and back left and right. All four of those pieces must equal at the waist whatever your hip measurement is, so you can pull them up over the hips. So that's going to have to be widened. A good way to widen that is decide how much more you want, and then just add out here at the side. Here again, we're doing the reverse of the legs down there. So you need to, at this point, decide, am I going to come out here this wide, whatever your hips need to be. I see that my hip is the widest right on this line. Therefore, I know without having to measure my pattern, as long as I use this dotted paper, and you can buy this both in paper and also in a fibrous material that's very inexpensive at your local fabric shop. So go in and see what they have for pattern work, and I'm sure you can find some. But I'd start right at this line, and I just make sure that my waistline comes out this wide so it can pull up over my hips, and then cut them out this wide. Then, of course, I'd need to have a waistband on. So you decide also whether you want a separate one or if you want to have it attached. And if I'm going to attach this waistband, I possibly will just measure how deep is the elastic, how wide is it. Take that times two. I'll grab a piece of elastic here. If I'm going to use this elastic, for instance, here's my waistline right along here. And I would need this much extra to do a casing, if I'm just going to add it and make it all in one piece. This much extra to come to the top. Again, that much extra so that it folds down and back. And a seam allowance. So it would be, if this is 1 inch elastic, which yes it is, I would need to add then 2 inches plus a seam and a little bit of leeway to get the elastic through easily. So I'd probably add close to 3 inches to the top. Now to do that, it's going to come straight up here anyway, so I would just keep going straight up from this point. And whatever from here, whatever 3 inches is, that's about 1, 2, about 3 to the top of the paper. So I just continue to go all the way up there and then across. Now also what every pattern manufacturer does is make the center front and the center back on the same level. That would mean that your waistline is parallel with the floor going all the way around. If this isn't true of you, you need to make an adjustment there. For instance, if you have a little bit of a tummy, probably you need to add a little extra height right there at the top. And so this could present problems if you had an elasticized waist and wanted to add that casing to it and make it all in one piece. Now if you were going to have a waistband, it's not really much of a problem. You just get a nice fluid curve with a whatever device you want and kind of round it off here. Basically, anytime you have an angle here, a vertical line meeting a horizontal line, almost always that should be a right angle. If this is raised enough for your tummy that it would come way up here and down, realize that would come up to a point in front. So that isn't going to work. You somehow need to round that out a little bit, smooth it out, however high you take it. But anyway, think about that. Think about also, is your waist and back on an even keel all around? Or a lot of you have a waist that dips a little bit in back. If that's the case, I don't have a back pattern right here with me, but if that's the case, the center back would dip down a little bit. Okay, think about that top, the front, coming up higher, and the back coming down lower. And if you're adding 3 inches to that, think about folding that 3 inches down and you're going to have a little problem with it. As it folds down, the front of it with the higher waistline would want to jut out here, and the back waistline as it comes down would want to fold in a little bit, and it wouldn't quite work. This is when you would want a separate casing, one that you sew on. So think about that accordingly. Well, let's think also about pleats, and pleats are very easy to do. Now, we know that what we have with this dart that was already in here, we know that what we have here in the dart is about 1 inch of fabric that we don't need for our waistline. So we already have one pleat there if we want it, if an inch is going to be enough. I'm just going to show a couple of pleats here, and notice how this one, if I put my finger in it, I have about a half inch pleat here. So that's a total of 1 inch of fabric in here. So 1 inch I already have. That one pleat is already here in that dart space. I don't need to add. But if I want a second pleat, then I'd have to come out here wider, which I've already done by making this straight line. But if I don't want to elasticize these, I do already have two pleats in it. I have the space for it. And then when I put this on and adjust it in front of a mirror, I'll just put those pleats in where they look best, divide them on my body. Sometimes, notice how these pleats are turned in. What that does is make your tummy look a little flatter if the pleat's turned in. If, on the other hand, the pleat would be turned out, that rounds your tummy out a little bit more. So think about that also, which direction can make a difference. So two pleats are kind of general. Three pleats are sometimes used. That's a possibility also. So divide it however you want, whatever looks best on you. and make those pleats if that's your preference. Now what I have down here are all elasticized pants. As I said, all of these are made from the same pattern, and it's just so easy to change them. Now this one, before I put it down, has a crease pressed front and back. And the way you press a crease before I drop it is to just put the inseam and the side seam right together. And once you have those together, what you press, here's the crease on each side. They aren't necessarily balanced very often. The front's bigger than the back. But anyway, the two seams will be together. And so this is how you would press a crease all the way up. But these, the rest of them don't have creases, as so many pants don't. These are just very soft ones, and I do have elastic. Notice it's narrow elastic. It really didn't present much of a problem, because it's narrow, to fold down that casing that's attached and stitch it on this way. If, on the other hand, you have wide elastic, as I have in these pants, then it's a good idea to have a seam right here and have a separate casing, because you aren't going to be able to turn it down very easily. This is something that you see done commercially quite often. Now this is that really wide sports elastic. You can stitch right through it, and it's not going to hurt the elastic at all. It'll still retain the same amount of stretch and recovery. What I've done here really at the front is just make a little buttonhole on each side, and this cord is simply attached inside here. It doesn't really even go all the way around the waistline. But this is a possibility by just doing this and doing any matching cord. What I have here are a couple of knits. Now, as far as the legs go, these knits have completely different size legs because of the weight of the fabric. So, this one is a heavier knit, and so these legs are narrower. This one is not only a lighter weight knit, but also it's a rayon knit, and it has a lot of weight. It hangs nicely, it drapes nicely, so you're able to make those legs wider. But anyway, you decide on those legs. As far as this elastic goes, you have some decisions to make there too if you're going to put elastic in. And so I want to show you that in a minute, but before we do, let's think where this should start on the pattern if you are going to add that extra for gathers, for elasticized waists, or for pleats. Now, very often the pattern tells you that you can do this by adjusting all the way from the ankle. And so if you would do that, I don't have a long enough yardstick, I'll put my adjustable pattern back on it instead. If you would adjust this all the way from the ankle to make it bigger here, notice what happens to the whole length of the pants. I'm going to bring it out here wider, and notice how it starts getting wider immediately above the ankle. So the knees would be a lot bigger, it would be a lot bigger in the hip area, the whole thing gets bigger. Now, do you actually want the pants to be bigger all the way along or not? If it's lightweight fabric, again, okay. I have one pair at home of a very heavy linen, and I really don't care for them much because they're way too wide. So this is it, heavy, and you don't want that much heaviness, that much width if it's going to be heavy. Okay, so what usually probably you do instead of adjusting it all the way from the ankle is come up to about the knee and just there tilt it out and add the extra, so that from your knee on down the leg really doesn't change at all. It's just the upper part that changes when you need to add the fullness for the gathers or for the pleats. The back doesn't change at all, by the way. The back I didn't even bring on the table because it stays with darts no matter what you do to the rest of it. It can also have gathers to replace the darts, but you never put pleats in the pants back. You only put them in the front. So the back size remains the same whether you dart or gather it. But let's look at some elastic considerations also. Now, I've noticed that a lot of patterns or a lot of directions for putting in elastic say that what you need to do is serge that elastic onto the fabric first before you fold it over for a casing. Think about that and how possible it is, because it isn't possible for everyone to do that. If you're pretty much straight up and down, if your body is and your waist and hips don't have that much difference between them, then this is a good way to do it. It holds it all in place nicely. But if you are very shapely and have a small waist and large hips, then this is not going to be possible because the elastic simply won't stretch that much. If it won't stretch out big enough to go over your hips and then come into your waist size, then you have a problem there if you have it all attached like this. You can't stretch it out far enough to put it on your fabric. That's exactly the problem I found with these shorts. Now, these were made from a commercial pattern. And with these shorts, the only elastic is in back. Not a good idea if you're very shapely, because with that back elastic and none in front, this back has to stretch out big enough to fit your hips, because the front isn't going to change. It's set in its size. It's only the back that'll stretch out. Now, what they also recommended that you do there is stretch out that elastic. And here's how much extra they recommended, that you have about 3 inches of extra there beyond what you want in your waist that you would cut off later. And that's to get a good hold on it and stretch it out while you're doing it. I found it wouldn't stretch the same size as the fabric. If I did stretch it out to the limit and sew it on that way, it takes a lot of muscle for one thing, but also it wouldn't condense then. It wouldn't retract enough for my waistline. So I had to make a little compromise there and bring that elastic around more than they had intended for it to. I would therefore, if you're very shapely, put elastic in the whole thing and not just limit it to the back side, because that does present a problem. As far as the other way to do it, it would be making your casing first, folding it down, stitching it in place. I'll fold this side over instead. You'd stitch it all in place, leave an opening at one of the seams so that you could then string your elastic through and get it in there, and then attach it afterwards into a ring. Or the opposing way is to put it in a ring first, put it inside here even though it's a lot smaller than your band, and as you fold it down, just keep working it around the elastic as you stitch the casing down. Now, as far as how to attach it, a really nice way is to put some kind of reinforcement in back of it. For instance, here's a piece of grosgrain ribbon, or you might use twill tape, anything that's sturdy and that's really going to hold. Instead of overlapping that and attaching the elastic that way into a ring, it does present some, it's bulky. It isn't as sleek and professional as you might like it to be. So it might be a good idea to put something sturdy behind it, and you'd trim it down to the same size as the waistband afterwards. Or if your elastic's narrow enough, you would just put it here on each side and do it that way. I'm just going to do it this way to show you the idea. What I would do is put that reinforcement underneath and just butt the edges together. Don't overlap them at all, because it feels better this way. And I'd set it on zigzag and then go ahead and zigzag through the center so that I get these two pieces of elastic on. And if I would raise the feed dog, that would help. Okay, and then besides this, you know, if you put much strain on this, it's going to come loose. So besides this, you might want to do another row on each side so that it's really sturdy and you won't have any problems. And then do another row on the other side as well, and it's going to come out very nicely. Now, there's some elastic on the market in the last few years that has a little tie in it as well as just being elastic. But this way it's very sturdy, it will never come apart, and it's very flat and sleek. Well, that kind of new elastic looks like this. It has this little string in it. Don't pull that out initially, because it will never retract. Once you have it pulled, it's there to stay. So what I would do if I wanted to put this together, I could do that band the same way and just avoid that string. But remember, once you pull that string out, that's it. It's going to stay there and it won't retract. This is a good kind of elastic to use though, and it does the job very nicely. And in fact, that's what I'm wearing right now. I have one of these elastics in my band so that it ties here. It actually does nothing as far as holding your pants up. The elastic does that. It's really just a little decorative thing. But if you're going to have this, realize that you have to have something in front for that elastic to come through, and that something would be, again, as I had on another pair of pants there, a couple little buttonholes for the elastic to come out through the fabric and tie in place there, or perhaps just one buttonhole right in the center, or leave that center seam open a little bit. Just don't stitch the whole thing. Leave open enough that you can bring these two strings out and tie a little bow there, and have something a little decorative as well as something functional. If you want to have some non-roll elastic, that's also possible. There are non-roll waistbands of various sorts. So go look through the ready-to-wear and see what your preferences are, and definitely, to make these decisions, try on all the different type pants that they have and make sure that you look the nicest in them, since there are so many choices. When you look at a model standing in pants, she just doesn't necessarily look the way you do, so you need to actually try them on before you do the cutting out and before you do any of the stitching. So a lot of different things that you might do, a lot of different variables, a lot of changes, because you're the designer always when you sew, and you can change it any way that seems applicable to your particular set of problems. Well, with those decisions made, then move on down to the best hem for the project. Not only for pants, but for every garment, it needs special attention in that area. Let's get together next time and experiment with some hemming ways.